Good morning to the entire house and respected chairperson. I would like to thank American College of Physicians, especially the India chapter and Dr. Anuj Maheshwari for inviting me here and honoring us with the fellowship. So my topic is managing a catastrophe. Why the Sunday morning right at destination Goa we are discussing about a catastrophe? So the problem with pulmonary embolism is in my graduation days they told us that what we see as pulmonary embolism is just the tip of the iceberg. So more than 50% of pulmonary embolism goes undetected, and it's a post-mortem diagnosis in country like US. All right. So my talk is basically it is dependent on these recent recommendations. One of them is European Society of Cardiology. In consensus with European Respiratory Society 2019, which was again highlighted in World Journal of Cardiology, and latest was ASH guideline, the American Society of Hematology 2020. Why it is important to diagnose? Because when we talk about management, diagnosing a problem is very, very important. So the symptoms of pulmonary embolism will be chest pain, hemoptysis, acute onset breathlessness, syncope, dizziness, fainting, fever or leg pain. So these are overlapping symptoms because symptoms will be limited. In a patient of empyema, we will get these symptoms. In a patient of necrotizing pneumonia, almost all symptoms will be present. In a patient of heart failure with secondary chest infection, these symptoms can be present. So how will we differentiate that this is not pneumonia? Because even on radiology, a pulmonary infarct might look like a pneumonia. So it is very important to differentiate it from other common conditions. And for that, these guidelines have given us scoring systems. So there are strong risk factors like fracture of lower limb, hospitalization for heart failure or atrial fibrillation, hip or knee replacement, major trauma, myocardial infarction in last 3 months, previous venous thromboembolism, or spinal injury. These are major risk factors. So any patient with these symptoms and major risk factors should consider the embolism as possible cause for risk. The other risk factors are, there is a long list, I'll not go in that. And there are weak risk factors also, like bed rest or diabetes or arterial hypertension, immobility. So there is a revised Geneva score. This is very important because if any patient scores more than 3 on a simplified Geneva score, the PE or pulmonary embolism is the most likely diagnosis. What are the factors to be considered? The previous history of embolism or DVT, the heart rate between 75 to 94, or a heart rate of 95, which will score for 2, then surgery or fracture in last 1 month, hemoptysis as a symptom, active cancer, this is another high risk factor, the neurological lower limb pain, pain of lower limb deep venous palpation or unilateral edema, and age of more than 65 years. These are the factors, and they are given 1 point each, except the heart rate of 95, which is given 2 points. And when we calculate, the score of 0 to 1 is low risk, the score of 2 to 4 is intermediate risk, and a score of more than 5 is high risk for possibility of a pulmonary embolism. So in a clinical picture or symptoms with high risk score for pulmonary embolism, now we come with the third thing, whether there is hemodynamic instability or not. So any patient who is suspected of having pulmonary embolism and hemodynamically unstable, this is the moment you start treatment with unfractionated reserve. If bedside transthoracic echocardiography is available, do it. It can exclude the PE because a hemodynamically unstable patient should demonstrate right heart failure or pulmonary heart hypertension or these kind of features on pulmonary the transthoracic echocardiography. Once you suspect that there is RV dysfunction on this thoracic echography, then you go ahead with the CT pulmonary angio, which is the gold standard test for any suspected pulmonary embolism. In a low risk category, you still go ahead and do a D-dimer test on an echocardiography. If D-dimer is positive, you go ahead and do a CT pulmonary angio. But if you are strongly suspecting clinically pulmonary embolism and there is hemodynamic instability, there is no need to repeat or there is no need to do a D-dimer or wait for the D-dimer report, you straight away start the treatment and go ahead with the CT pulmonary angio. And these are the criteria for hemodynamic instability, need for cardiopulmonary resuscitation or a persistent systolic BP of less than 90 or treatment of vasopressor support and systolic BP of less than 90 even after starting the vasopressor. or there are organ dysfunctions, like there is oliguria, there is altered mental status, or the skin is scammy. So all these features will be suggestive of hemodynamic instability. So this is high risk P in a hemodynamically unstable patient. The moment you suspect or diagnose it, you start treatment with unfractionated heparin, and you monitor the APTT every 4 to 6 hours, and the target APTT will be 50 to 60. If unfractionated heparin or monitoring is not available, then definitely you start anticoagulant in therapeutic doses. It can be LMWH, it can be Fontabarinox, but you give it weight-adjusted therapeutic doses. And suspected PE without hemodynamic instability, you start with therapeutic anticoagulation. This is the pulmonary embolism severity index, and this is a very important list because we need to have all these lists in our phone, because there are pocket guidelines are also available from European Society of Cardiology, and this will decide when a patient is fit for shifting from ICU to ward or from ward to home care. So any patient with a score of more than 125 will definitely have a high mortality rate in the next 30 days, and this is a prognostic marker. So we have discussed already with the treatment for high risk PE. We start with unfractionated heparin. Then systemic thrombolysis is one of the things which will be required. So we call it the second line treatment. Whenever we see that we have started patient on unfractionated heparin, despite of the fact starting these medication, if the right heart pressures are rising, if patient has worsening of heart failure, if there is worsening of respiratory failure, then you start with thrombolytic therapy. So we have three options for thrombolytic therapy. One is systemic thrombolytic therapy, then catheter-directed thrombolytic therapy, which will be attempted by either interventional cardiologist or interventional radiologist. If both the things are not available, then definitely we will talk about IVC filter. So these are the three main drugs used for thrombolysis, and very often nowadays we are only using Etiplase or recombinant tissue plasminogen activator. The absolute contraindication for using thrombolysis is history of hemorrhage, ischemic stroke in previous 6 months, central nervous system neoplasia, major trauma or surgery within 3 weeks, bleeding diastasis or active bleeding. These are absolute contraindication for using any thrombolysis therapy. So patient with hemodynamic instability, massive pulmonary embolism, confirmed and diagnosed, and has got contraindication for thrombolysis. In these patients, either we can attempt catheter-directed thrombolysis, or we can definitely recommend end arteriectomy or surgical thrombolysis. In patients who fall in intermediate or low risk acute pulmonary embolism, the treatment is you start directly with the anticoagulation, LMWX or Fontabarinox in therapeutic doses, and definitely we can switch over to oral anticoagulants. So present guidelines recommend that newer oral anticoagulants, NOACs, like dabigatran or rivaroxaban or apixaban, these are preferred agent over the conventional vitamin K antagonist like warfarin or acetron. But the contraindication for NOAC is like pregnancy, very severe renal failure or liver failure, and definitely patients with EPFA syndrome or antiphospholipid syndrome. IVC filter is recommended only in two conditions. One, when thrombolysis is actually contraindicated. And second, despite of starting therapeutic anticoagulation, if patient is throwing showers of pulmonary embolism and has definitive DVT in proximal veins, you go ahead and put an IVC filter. But routine IVC filter is not recommended. Discharge, any low-risk patient can be discharged if he can take care at home. He is not alone at home, and he can be monitored, and he is good enough to administer the drugs himself. And any patient with high-risk pulmonary embolism should be stabilized and brought down to oral anticoagulant before discharging. So main important flags are like high degree of suspicion. Why I mentioned the gastro patient, because we have n number of patients. There was this especially mention, I'll tell you that there was a young patient, 27-year-old tailor by the profession. He got admitted in gastroenterology department for the pain in upper abdomen on the right side. He underwent ultrasonography, which was normal. His amylase, lipase was perfectly fine. The next day, patient underwent for upper GI endoscopy, which was also normal. There was no ulceration. And that was the time when gastroenterologist did a CT of the abdomen. The CT of abdomen picked up a very small supradiaphragmatic pneumonia. And for that, the pulmonology consultation was taken. When I reviewed this patient, the primary complaint patient had was pain, and which was radiating from lower chest to abdomen. Pneumonia typically doesn't present with pain. Pneumonia will have fever, cough, breathlessness. Whenever the pain is unusual to the presentation of pneumonia, do suspect pulmonary embolism. Because of this particular single symptom, I have diagnosed n number of young pulmonary embolism cases. So we went ahead and did a CTPA, and it was a pulmonary infarct in a young active tailor who was moving around every day. And on further workup, we could find that he had protein C deficiency, which is very, very common. So there was another challenge, which I will discuss in the next slide, that a patient of pulmonary embolism presenting with massive hemoptysis. Now, how do you treat? The pulmonary embolism will require anticoagulation. The massive hemoptysis will require procoagulants. So how do you treat it? It's totally juxtaposite. So anyways, we managed this case. This was a young high court lawyer, and we managed it and we published that case also. In pulmonary embolism, a travel history is very, very important. I have seen pulmonary embolism in patients who traveled from Patna to Lucknow, just 2 to 3 hours, 4 hours road journey, and they had pulmonary embolism, young patients. And later on, they just show that they have protein deficiency, protein S deficiency. And even his father had this protein S deficiency, and they have pulmonary embolism in the family. So these kind of high degree of suspicion is very important. Unfortunately, I remember one more patient that was non-responding pulmonary embolism. So this lady of almost 55 years of age landed up with right heart failure. We diagnosed very timely that it is on CTPA, that it is pulmonary embolism. We gave her thrombolysis, we gave her anticoagulant, we discharged her after certain hospitalization. She got admitted every 3 months with right heart failure. And later on, when we did a PET, we actually found that it was pulmonary artery myxoma. It was not pulmonary embolism. So we need to have all of your diagnosis in our mind. So regular update of knowledge is definitely very important. And a multidisciplinary approach, because even when patients are admitted with pulmonary embolism to me, I definitely take consultation from international radiology people. And for this massive pulmonary embolism person, we went ahead for thrombolysis in pulmonary embolism with a catheter directly. So directly the catheter was inserted inside the pulmonary artery and thrombolysis was done. And do not forget that nowadays we are in a COVID era. We are facing post-COVID syndrome, and COVID per se is a high-risk state for thromboembolism because the basic pathology is microvascular thromboinflammatory disorder. I personally have treated thousands of COVID patients, and for all serious recovered COVID patients or serious ARDS COVID patients, we had given them therapeutic anticoagulation at home for 3 weeks. And after stopping at 3 weeks, they landed up with this stroke. So it's such a thrombotic state, and thrombophilia profile should be taken. So this is one of the paper I was mentioning, the concurrent massive hemoptysis and pulmonary embolism. So for this patient, it was young patient, he was admitted in high court Delhi. We went ahead and did bronchial artery embolization for massive hemoptysis. Because of the past history of tuberculosis, he had a bleeding cavity in right upper lobe. For right upper lobe, bronchial artery embolization was done, and for pulmonary embolism, which was saddle shaped pulmonary embolism involving right main trunk of the pulmonary artery, we did. So both the procedures were done by international radiologists, and this patient is here in Hardy since 2 years, he is in follow-up. This is another patient, another thing which we presented in 2015 long time. Because for diagnosis of pulmonary embolism, we talk about PESI, we talk about risk score, we talk about CTPA, D-dimer. But this is one thing which we used in 2015, endobronchial ultrasound. So this patient was on ventilator in multi-organ failure, in shock, renal failure. We could not do CTPA, we could not do VQ scan. And we did on ventilator endobronchial ultrasound. And on ultrasound, inside the bronchus, we demonstrated that there is obstruction in the flow of the pulmonary artery.
Please conclude.
So this, and now this technique has been used very often nowadays. So if you Google search this, there are more than 15 papers presenting this same finding. This is another thing demonstrating the polo sign, polo mint hole sign in the peripheral veins. So So this is a single patient who had more than 11 radiological signs, a COVID patient who had more than 11 radiological signs, and one of them was pulmonary. He had GGO, he had arch shine, he had pneumothorax, he had pneumorachus. Pneumorachus is one thing, the air in the spinal column, even this finding was missed by the radiologist. So this was published and it was a very, very unique case. Thank you.